Thanks again for joining us for this teaching session on the Holy Spirit. I guess what we want to do in perhaps this last session, as we've been viewing the work of the Holy Spirit through the lens of Scripture, is really just refocus on spiritual gifts. I recognize that so much has been said about spiritual gifts that I suspect nothing I'm going to say in this session will sound new, but at least it gives us a chance to rethink what spiritual gifts are and what's the source behind them and how best they can be utilized in serving in the church. So I guess as we think about spiritual gifts, if as John, the writer of the fourth gospel, says about Jesus's words and actions, he says, you know, if it was all written down, all the books in the world could not contain them. Well, I think it's probably true to say that about gifts of the Spirit. So many books have been written, so much has been said, that it's become swamped with different ideas and different approaches. So I hope this session will just provide an opportunity to rethink and reassess and just put us back in that place where we return to see the work of the Holy Spirit through the lens of Scripture. I want to suggest that when it comes to spiritual gifts, viewing them through the lens of Scripture is absolutely vital, something very significant and important for us. In the session today, we're going to primarily focus on 1 Corinthians chapter 12 through to 14. Although it's fair to say that to get a fuller overview of spiritual gifts as a work of God's Holy Spirit, we will need to access different parts of Scripture too. Just a reminder as we approach this subject today, that right throughout these sessions, I've been approaching it from the viewpoint that every follower of Jesus, every true believer in Jesus, has been gifted with the Holy Spirit. We are all baptized in the Spirit into the church. There's no other route to become part of God's people. So true believers, all true believers, have the gift of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit lives within them and enables them to live and serve and become more like Jesus. Let me just refresh our minds with a scripture that really helps us to just re-engage with that fact. It's 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 13. For we are all baptized by one Spirit, so as to form one body, whether Jew or Gentile, slave or free, we were all given one Spirit to drink. When we come to think, as we will do in this session, about spiritual gifts, we're really utilizing its original definition from Scripture. And in the New Testament Greek, as we find it in the pages of the New Testament, within New Testament Greek, spiritual gifts, the word that is used to define spiritual gifts is charismata, charismata. Charis, of course, means grace, and mata means gift. So spiritual gifts are defined in Scripture as grace gifts. And from the word charismata, of course, we get the word charismatic, probably a word that we're more familiar with. Many Christians today would describe themselves as charismatic. Many churches or networks of churches would describe them as charismatic churches in that sense. And of course, using the original Greek language, grace gifts helps us to be reminded of how important it is that spiritual gifts are always talked about and thought about with a covering of grace. I think where Christians maybe in the past and maybe even today still have been made to feel second-class Christians, or whether they've been made to feel not as superior as some other Christians who perhaps have a whole huge array of spiritual gifts, it's really where the whole notion of spiritual gifts has been removed from the element of grace. Grace is something that helps us to understand that when it comes to understanding spiritual gifts, grace is at the very heart of them, and that grace needs to be reflected in the way that we talk about them. I think changing the language can help us to rethink our own understanding. And what I mean by that is quite simply that when it comes to a conversation about spiritual gifts, if we change the conversation, the language that is used in the conversation, then that helps us to rethink those things, perhaps with a different perspective. If we think of spiritual gifts as something that are personal attributes or something that we've required, something to get for ourselves, then I believe that we're really missing the whole point of grace gifts, spiritual gifts. What I mean by that is this. Gifts that we would describe as spiritual gifts, always, always belong to the giver. And it's the giver, the Holy Spirit, who sets the agenda for how those spiritual gifts are to be used as the means of furthering the well-being of the church and its mission to the world. I would suggest that if we see them as something that are on loan to us rather than our own personal possessions, then in that way we will begin to treasure them even more, and we will rely much more on the giver than the actual gift itself. So spiritual gifts in that sense are on loan. They are gifted to us, but they remain in the hands of the giver. And the focus of all conversations about spiritual gifts needs to be on the giver, the Holy Spirit, and how we can serve best and follow through on the work of God's Holy Spirit. If people then say to us that they recognize in us a particular spiritual gift, whether it's teaching or preaching, or whether it's encouragement, it's the gift of administration, or whatever, then of course that's immensely encouraging for us. But if they remain under the authority of the giver on loan to us, then of course the way that we receive those words of encouragement can be very different. We don't become self-conceited. We don't think, oh my goodness, I'm better than someone else in that way, or I'm more spiritually gifted than anyone else. We simply realize that we have been truly blessed by the giver of all good gifts, by God our Father through the Holy Spirit. It's only where spiritual gifts become our personal possession, or they become the identifying badge of a particular church, that I believe pride begins to creep in. And of course, having said all of that, that's in no way a discouragement to seek after spiritual gifts. Scripture reminds us to do that, as Paul does here in 1 Corinthians 12 and verse 31, where he says those words just before he moves into his wonderful meditation on love in chapter 13, he reminds us to earnestly desire the greater gifts. So holding that imbalance, creating a better perspective, I guess, would be to say that we earnestly seek after what God graciously can bestow upon our lives, the gifts that he has for us through his Spirit, but we recognize that they are always on loan, that the giver is much more important than the gift, and in that sense, I guess it would be true to say too, that at any time, spiritual gifts can be taken away from us. They are only on loan. So we value them, we appreciate them, but we treasure them with humility and with grace. What is the purpose of spiritual gifts? What are the purposes of spiritual gifts? I'm sure there are many reasons why the Holy Spirit distributes spiritual gifts amongst believers in the church, as he has done from the day of Pentecost right through to the church today, and of course the church in the future until the return of Jesus. And two key purposes, I believe, emerge out of what we read in this particular section from 1 Corinthians 12 through to 14. Two prime purposes that Paul helps us to grasp. The first one is that spiritual gifts are always given for the glory of God. They're not given that any church would be glorified, any individual believer, church leader would be glorified. Spiritual gifts are primarily given so that we might glorify God through our lives and through our actions. So firstly, spiritual gifts are given to the glory of God so that they might bring glory to our amazing God. Secondly, Paul defines for us that the purpose of spiritual gifts is that they might edify or build up the church. They are given to the church so that the church might gain insight and understanding, that the church might be able to engage in true discipline, and of course, ultimately, that the church might be able to engage in mission, our mission to bring Jesus to the world. Given the very human nature of the church, something I guess we all get caught up in at times, I'm sure, spiritual gifts can be used in a way that they were never meant to be used. They are not for self-gratification. They are not about us feeling superior in any way to anybody else. Primarily, they are there to glorify God and to edify the church, to build up the church. At times, if I'm honest, I think spiritual gifts have been used to elevate individuals, and alongside that have been used too to crush the spirit of a church and its ability to walk in the ways of Jesus. And not only a church, but sometimes to crush the spirit of an individual believer. None of that has any connection with the purpose behind the bringing of spiritual gifts through the Holy Spirit and those gifts being bestowed upon the believer. Paul helpfully uses a metaphor here to help us in our understanding, to see the vast range of spiritual gifts. And of course, the metaphor that he uses was a very familiar one in the Greek world where Paul lived and taught. And that, of course, is the metaphor or the image of the body. Let me read some of that again for you, this time from 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verses 12 to 20. Just as one body, though one, has many parts, but all its many parts form one body, so it is with Christ. For we were all baptized by one Spirit, so as to form one body, whether Jew or Gentile, slave or free, and we were all given the same Spirit to drink. Even so, the body is not made up of one part, but of many. Now, if the foot should say, because I'm not a hand, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being part of the body. And if an ear should say, because I'm not an eye, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? But in fact, God has placed the parts of the body, each one of them, just as he wanted them to be. If they were all one part, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, but one body. Paul here, obviously, is keen to emphasize the diversity of the gifts that come through the Holy Spirit into the life of individual believers and through the life of individual believers into the church and beyond that into our communities and into the wider world. I guess if Paul had lived at a different time, he could have used other metaphors. He chose to use the metaphor of a body because, of course, that was very prevalent at that time in Greek culture. He could have talked about an orchestra with the image of God as the conductor and each one of us playing a different instrument and when to blend it together, making this beautiful orchestrated sound that brings glory to God and edifies the church. He could, of course, have likened it to a sports team with a coach, where God is the coach, and the coach is imparting gifts and knowledge and insight and understanding and skills to us that enable us to be the kind of team that glorifies God and edifies and builds up the church. I guess he could have talked about the spokes around a hub of a wheel, where the hub was God and all the spokes represented each one of us. But of course, we're all linked together as part of the whole thing. We are all part of the wheel. Paul could have used any of those metaphors. He chose to use the body. Different parts, different functions, but his emphasis always is on the unity of the body, the oneness. It's essential that despite all the diversity, in fact, because of the diversity, there is the creation of oneness and unity as the church seeks to serve God through the use of spiritual gifts. When we become followers of Jesus, of course, we become part of the body of Christ, the church as we know it. And there we function, and there we bring our unique talents and gifts and abilities alongside those spiritual gifts that have been brought to us, gifted to us through the Holy Spirit. And it's in the church and through the ministry of the church, the mission of the church into the world, that all that potential that God has stored up in our lives is released in a way that brings glory to God and builds up the church. It overflows into the life of the church, and through the church, it overflows into the life of the community, into our neighborhoods, into our streets where we live. It's there that we serve and we act for Jesus with all those natural abilities and talents that we have, alongside those beautiful spiritual gifts that God has gifted to us through His Holy Spirit. Scripture shows us that there is a great diversity of gifts that are mentioned. Let me read some of those for you from 1 Corinthians 12 and verses 8 to 10. We have these spiritual gifts: wisdom, knowledge, faith, healing, miracles, prophecy, discernment, tongues, and interpretation of tongues. If you come to the end of chapter 12 and verse 28, you will see there's some additional spiritual gifts: apostleship, teachers, helpers, and administrators. If you refer back to Romans, Paul's letter to the church in Rome, and chapter 12 and verses 6 to 8, then you will find listed there other spiritual gifts: serving, encouragement, contributing to the needs of others, leadership. And again, then in Ephesians 4, verses 11 to 13, the gift of mercy, the gift of evangelism, pastors. And then in 1 Peter 4 and verses 8 to 11, the gifts of love and hospitality. And I'm sure that there are others in Scripture that you will come across with a little bit of digging about. Check it out for yourselves. It's a lovely thing to be able to see the whole range, the whole spectrum of spiritual gifts that God has poured out into the church through His Holy Spirit. And I don't believe that this list is meant to be fixed, that this is predetermined, that this is the only gifts that there are. I believe that there are many, many gifts of the Spirit that aren't necessarily mentioned here. Gifts that fulfill those two purposes. Firstly, they glorify God, and secondly, they edify the church. And under the anointing of the Holy Spirit, they are used to bring blessing to God's people, and beyond that, into our communities, our streets, and into our towns. It's not meant to be an exhaustive list in that sense. Unlike me, I often run out of ideas for gifts for people. Thankfully, the Holy Spirit never falls into that particular bracket. The Holy Spirit, it has so many gifts, some mentioned in Scripture, some that we can see and discern as being at work in the church. And they bring great blessing and encouragement to all of us. I just wanted to make some observations about the difference between natural gifts and spiritual gifts. I don't particularly want to get too hung up on this and make a big thing of it, but just to point out one or two things for us to have a chance to think about. I guess our natural gifts are part of our genetic inheritance. They are birthed in us, part of our DNA in that sense. Other gifts emerge through the way that we're nurtured, we're brought up, the kind of education, the things that we learn, the skills that we pick up as we go through life. So all of that is very important, and of course of immense blessing both to us and to the church. Spiritual gifts, I think, are those gifts that are brought to us after we become followers of Jesus. Simply put, everyone can have natural gifts, but only Christians can have spiritual gifts? Can and does God work through natural gifts? Absolutely. Yes, he does. I completely believe that. Can he work through the natural gifts of people who are not yet Christians? Absolutely. I believe that to be true too. And I think there are many examples of that in Scripture. Some have tried to pin it down. I came across this observation. Some would argue that natural gifts reveal our human talents, whereas spiritual gifts reveal the supernatural abilities of God. Well, to be honest, I wouldn't particularly want to hold too close to that. Maybe it's just too black and white for me. I'm a bit of a dodgy grey person, as you're becoming increasingly aware. After all, aren't our human talents, don't they emerge out of the fact that we've been created in the image of God? So I don't think you can simply say that one is human and one is spiritual. I think there has to be some overlap going on there. As I say, and I'm trying not myself to fall into the trap, don't get hung up on this. Just use whatever we have for God's glory and the building up of his church. Don't worry whether it's a natural talent, it's something that's been nurtured, something that you've gained through education or learning from others, or whether it's a spiritual gift that has been brought since that time when we gave our lives to Jesus. Just use whatever we have, all that we have, for the glory of God and the building up of his church. I wanted to finish this whole series, or mini-series, I guess it's probably better defined as, on seeing the work of God's Holy Spirit through the lens of Scripture. I wanted to finish with the words that we find right at the very heart of this particular passage of Scripture, 1 Corinthians 12 through to 14. Words, of course, taken from 1 Corinthians 13 and verses 1 to 7. Let me read those. If I speak in the tongues of men or of angels, but do not have love, I am only a resounding gong or clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mystery and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, I have nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but do not have love, I gain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. I don't think there's any better place to finish our series on viewing the work of God's Holy Spirit through the lens of Scripture than at that place where we're reminded that at the heart of all conversations about spiritual gifts or any work that the Holy Spirit is engaged with, any participation that we have in all of that in the church and beyond the church into the wider community, all of that needs to come under this great mandate of Jesus to love one another as the means of showing the world that we are truly disciples of Jesus. I want to just take this opportunity of saying thank you to you for being part of our conversation. Please get in touch Many of you have my email address, but you can do that via Facebook and lots of other means of action if you would like to talk about anything that we've said over these weeks and engage in a positive conversation together. That would be a lot of fun for me and hopefully for you as well. So thank you so much for being part of this. My intention is to continue to put these teaching sessions together for the foreseeable future. Maybe we will come to that moment when we're able to have a few more on site so that it can be more of a discussion, something interactive rather than a dialogue. Forgive me for the fact it's been a bit of a dialogue. It's not really my natural way of wanting to engage people in a conversation. But from this, after today, I'm going to suggest that we're going to, I'm going to do a little bit of a cook's holiday kind of tour of the book of Revelation. So if you're up for that and you're up for some more challenges, then it would be absolutely great for you to be able to join in with that. We will be working our way through the book of Revelation and seeing it from a particular perspective, which I hope will engage you and all of us in lots of interesting conversations. May you be blessed, and thank you for being part of these Tuesday evenings or whenever you've been able to access this online. Can I also acknowledge my cameraman and the one who's sorted out all the problems that we've had with all the wiring and everything else, and that's Brian Langston, who's done a magnificent job for us to enable us to be able to be part of this. So thank you to Brian too. Be blessed, and hopefully we'll see you next week.